So let's get started with another inlay project.
Here, I've rough turned several salt and pepper mill bodies with one common feature. They all have cracks.
I'll be carving in and around these cracks to disguise the defects.
Before I carve, I'd like to introduce the tools I use for carving. While you can use hand carving tools and knives, it's too slow for production work, so I turn to power tools. I have an assortment of power carving tools here that has one thing in common, the flexible shaft. This allows me to manipulate the carving bit in a more fluid-like manner rather than fixed into position on a rotary tool like this Dremel. Fortunately, if you own a Dremel rotary tool, you can purchase an attachment called a flex shaft. It gives you the freedom of movement when carving with small bits without the need to hold the motor. It's lightweight, maneuverable, and one of my most used attachments. You can also use a mini air grinder for carving. They are lightweight and inexpensive, but are loud and need an air compressor capable of producing enough air to supply the tool for a usable amount of time. Here's a rotary tool that emulates a professional dental model that works quite well for this type of carving. This shaft is also interchangeable with industry standard handpieces. I'm using an H28 handpiece. It's slightly smaller than the included handpiece and easier to control with the small cutters I use. This tool also features a foot pedal speed control that frees both of my hands for the carving task. It's a nice safety feature. If I need to stop the machine immediately, I can respond quickly by lifting my foot off the control. Again, you'll also want to protect your face and eyes from dust and wood chips by wearing eye protection and dust mask. A carving glove can protect your hands too, so wear one, especially when you're just learning to carve. Carving wood with power tools is accomplished with an assortment of bits. They come in a variety of shapes and sizes, so experiment with several to explore the possibilities of cutting different shapes, grooves, and channels. Practice with each cutter prior to carving your first keeper to get a feel on how it will respond to the various speeds of the rotary tool for the optimum cut. So always start out slow and increase the speed to see how the cutter will handle it. The bit I'll be using for most of the cuts on this DVD is a diamond-shaped steel cutter. You can find sources for these tools on my website. And please refer to all manufacturers' labels for proper product usage. Most hand-operated rotary tools spin in a counterclockwise direction, so all my cuts are made in a top-down or right-to-left motion because of the spin on the cutter. This gives me total control over the direction of cut. This is the cutting edge. By plunging the cutter into your work, you can cut a thin, shallow V-groove or a deep V-cut and everything in between. This allows me to control the quality of line by varying the width of cut. It's similar to drawing with a quill pen. Avoid starting a cut at the top of forms because the cutter has a tendency to catch and run around the form, plowing the cutter into your finger. It's best to turn your work upside down and continue to start your cuts from the side. The same is true in shallow curves at the top of forms. Don't attempt to make any cuts in this area. Instead, flip your work and proceed in this orientation. Tuck your elbows into your side and use your thumb for support on all the cuts. Don't expect to make each cut in one pass. The deeper the cut, the more light passes are required for a safe and controlled cut, and let the tool do the cutting. Before making my first cut, I like to sketch some lines in pencil over the surface of the cracked piece. While I could just fill the crack and have a plain line of metal, I prefer to hide the fact that the crack even existed. By sketching and then carving several curves that incorporate movement, I can conceal the original crack and add interest and appeal to the inlay. The combinations of curves I use are similar, but since there are no templates or plans to follow, each carving becomes unique and individual. This piece is prepped and ready for carving. The crack on this side of the mill proceeds into the bottom of the base. I'll handle that in a second operation when cutting the base. The top is cracked as well. I can carve and fill that at the same time I do the side, because I will have clearance when mounting it back on the lathe. Carving begins by laying in a series of light cuts. This establishes the direction of the initial channel. I'm also widening the gap on the original crack and cleaning up any torn edges. Keep the movement of the handpiece flowing when entering and exiting each pass. This will give you a nice transition between the beginning and the ending of each cut. If you are attempting to cut an arc, try to get as smooth a line as possible on the first pass. My left hand is actually making the turn, not the tool. Watch the movement of my hands closely as I cut some more curves. Each new initial cut overlaps the previous cut slightly. This helps the cutter to stay on the same path. Take note as to how this line develops slowly. A sharp cutter and light passes are extremely important when cutting the first pass on curves. The first cut establishes the path, and the second cut establishes depth. The next several cuts correct any errors the first two created, and may add depth as well. Once I'm pleased with the depth of the channel, I start to concentrate on the smoothness of the side edges of the curve. I also begin to pay attention to the thickness of the line. If you can't see your work because the sawdust is building up, blow it away and continue to refine the curves. Slow down slightly at the intersections and anticipate the cutter reacting a bit differently when crossing an intersecting line, as you see here. In order to widen the previously cut path, be aware that this side of the cutter, as well as this side, removes material when pulled in this direction or pushed this way. It is not just a plunge cut cutter. Keep this in mind when refining the curves. It will add an enormous amount of control and detail to the quality of line. By incorporating these techniques, I'm going to broaden out this curve here by pulling the cutter to the left and making the path a little bit wider. This creates a fuller curve with a much nicer transition from thick to thin. I usually don't like to leave individually carved lines running off the form. I much rather prefer to see an intersecting line to stop the eye from flowing off the form. While these two lines intersect, they still tend to carry your eye off the form. So I've sketched in some pencil lines to prevent that from happening. This should also help to visually balance the adjacent intersecting line as well. Use the pencil lines only as a guide when carving. Don't try to trace over them with the cutter. If you do that, you won't cut fluid lines. Study the relationship of all the cut lines and how they play off one another. You really want to focus on the line you're cutting and how it develops. The trickiest part of cutting fluid curves is trying to get the cutter to enter the previous cut. By doing so, you create a seamless, fluid line. This can only be achieved with practice, so take your time in the early stages when learning to carve, and it will become second nature before you know it. These overlapping lines help to create a visual focal point. If your handpiece seems to be getting in the way when making acute cuts on the inside of coves, as it does when I try to cut the design on this part of the mill, try flipping the piece around and attacking it from a different angle. You'll notice now that the handpiece has nothing to bump up against, and I can swing the cutter through a smooth arc, cutting a fluid line. The weight of this carving feels a little bottom heavy, so don't be afraid to experiment by penciling new designs on top of your carvings to see how it will work. That looks like an improvement, so I think I'll carve that right in. Notice how I'm supporting this mill up against my chest after the initial turn. It helps to support the base. A few more refining passes, an extension on this line, and the design feels a little more balanced. And I do like the balance on the opposite side as well. Now that I have a handful of carved projects, let's fill them all with copper inlay. Learn more about metal inlay on my DVD titled Metal Inlay Techniques for Wood Turning and Woodworking. The learning curve for metal inlay is fast, easy, and fun, and you'll be creating highly desirable unique pieces in no time.